Hi, hello, hi. So today, I want to talk to you all about ADHD. So we're gonna start with what is ADHD and how does it manifest itself? And some reasons why I think some people are misdiagnosed or there's an underdiagnosis, especially in AFAB individuals. So before we commence this topic, I would like to just specify that I am not a doctor. None of this is the opinion of a professional. I am merely someone who has ADHD and someone who is studying psychology, but that is it. I am not specialized in any of this, so please, you know, think critically. Let me know if you disagree with anything. Look into things yourself, ask a professional, all that cool stuff. I'm just giving you my opinions and telling you what I've learned. So ADHD stands for Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, and there are three main types of ADHD. As it stands right now, you know, research is always advancing. There are new versions of the DSM released regularly, so as of the time that this video is being made, there are three main types of ADHD. So there's the inattentive type of ADHD, the hyperactive impulsive type, and combination type. So I won't get into super detail about those because, again, I'm trying to break these down into quicker videos, easier to watch and digest videos, and I could get more into the three types in a different video. But real quick, inattentive ADHD is characterized by problems regulating your attention, but without the presence of the physical hyperactivity that some people come to expect. This before was what we used to consider ADD, so difficulty paying attention to detail, forgetfulness, processing information a little slower, and making more mistakes, even when you're trying very hard not to make mistakes. It's sometimes misinterpreted as carelessness, etc. So that's the type of ADHD that doesn't manifest itself with the physical hyperactivity. Next is hyperactive and impulsive ADHD. This is, as the name would suggest, characterized by impulsive behavior, hyperactive behavior, the stereotypical, like, kid who can't really sit still, fidgets a lot, speaks out of turn, could be impatient, fidgeting, squirming, having trouble waiting their turn, etc. All of those are the stereotypical manifestations of the impulsive type of ADHD. And then there's combined type, which, as you could imagine, means that it is a combination of the inattentive type of ADHD and the hyperactive ADHD. It could be that the symptoms don't always manifest themselves simultaneously. It could be that in some circumstances the person has hyperactivity, while in other circumstances they have inattentive symptoms, or it could be the combination of both at the same time. So those are the three main types of ADHD. Mostly what I want to address today is kind of all the in-between things. I'm going to make a separate video about things like hyperfocusing and stimming. Stay tuned for that. But in this video, I want to address what is the current popular theory on what ADHD is, what causes ADHD. I also want to talk about hypoactivity. So hyperactivity, as you can imagine, means, you know, hyperactive. Hyper being a lot, sometimes too much, and active. Hypoactivity is actually the opposite. It means being kind of lethargic, a lack of energy, seemingly exhausted, sluggish, all that stuff. Some people don't realize that ADHD sometimes manifests itself in hypoactivity, or that sometimes the hyperactivity is actually present in the mind. Like, yes, there is a difficulty paying attention, but there's also that hyperactivity. It's not just, oh, I can't focus. It's also like your mind is thinking about a lot of things simultaneously, or jumping from one thing to the other, or it kind of just, for me, it feels kind of like, you know, when you put your headphones in your pocket and you take them out and they're just this ball that you can't untangle. Sometimes that's how it feels in my brain. Like, I can't start or end a sentence. It kind of just feels like you're jumping in the middle of something and then you jump out and you're like, wow, there was no context to that and it made no sense. That is an obstacle that I often face when I'm filming these videos. It feels like I just jump into the center of something and I don't know where I started or where I'm going, and I'm like, and that's it. But I didn't realize that hypoactivity was a symptom of ADHD, and that's what kind of made it difficult for me to realize that I had this and that I was dealing with this. Sometimes ADHD could be misinterpreted as laziness, or as depression, or as anxiety. As you could imagine, if you are explaining yourself and saying that my thoughts feel like they're all jumbled up and it feels like my brain is jumping from one thing to the other, and you're speaking really quickly, much like I'm doing now but trying not to, there's a good chance your doctor or psychologist or psychiatrist might just think you have anxiety. They think we need to treat the anxiety because they think that that is the cause. But funny enough, the anxiety is actually just a symptom of the ADHD. One of the current theories as to why ADHD exists, or what causes ADHD, is the one that says that it comes from a lack of dopamine. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter. Real short, real sweet, dopamine is the reward center of your brain. I feel that it really explains what I've experienced and what a lot of other folks have experienced with ADHD, especially the ones that aren't 100% just like hyperactive type. I have combined ADHD, so I experience a mix of inattentive ADHD and hyperactive ADHD. Today I happen to be having a hyperactive kind of day, and I've learned to kind of just take advantage when it happens because I do experience exhaustion because of my physical limitations, so today I'm filming like 5 videos. So what is the whole dopamine thing? The reason why it is believed that low levels of dopamine are linked to ADHD is because the theory is that your brain, not having enough dopamine, is trying to get it anywhere that it can. It kind of explains why ADHD manifests itself in so many different ways, not only from person to person, but even within the same person, it could come about in a lot of different symptoms. So in some cases, because of the low levels of dopamine, the individual will experience hyperactivity. And the reason for this is because your brain is looking for that reward. It's looking for dopamine. So it's going to jump from one thing to the other, because if it's new, the chances are you're going to get that surge of dopamine. You know, it's kind of like when you get something new and you're excited about it and you're just like, I want to touch this thing. I want to do things with this thing. This is cool. I like this thing. You know, it's not to be materialistic, but it's just, I'm trying to explain this to someone neurotypical, you know, or someone who just doesn't have ADHD. Getting excited over a new thing, I think that that's a pretty universal feeling. But with everything, that feeling of something being new, there's the initial surge of excitement of like, oh cool, a new thing. But it does go away. The novelty of it doesn't last, so the initial surge of dopamine is quickly outlived. With ADHD, it's like that with everything. The brain will try to jump from one thing to the other, and because things are always new, it's kind of just trying to get as much dopamine as it can. And that individual will get bored or lose interest really quickly because dopamine does kind of help you remain interested in something. Now, with the inattentive type of ADHD, the dopamine theory also makes sense because dopamine is the reward center, but it is also a key component in motivation. So you're having trouble focusing, you're having trouble getting things done, and it's like dopamine oftentimes is a big player in us getting anything done, like even just housework. You do housework because you want to have a clean environment because it's rewarding. If you're not getting a reward for doing it, then you're just exhausting yourself. There's also executive dysfunction that comes with ADHD. I made a video about this. I'm not sure if this video will be out before or after. It would make more sense to release that video before this one, so I don't know, we'll see. But executive dysfunction, which is real short, real sweet, basically the difficulty or inability to get tasks done, to start tasks, to see them through, etc., to focus on them, to understand them, to break things down, all that stuff, that's executive dysfunction. It makes a lot of sense that that would come from a lack of dopamine. Without the dopamine and without the reward and without the motivation to get things done, it's not that you feel like a conscious sense of lack of motivation. It's not like you could instill that motivation in yourself. It's not even like an emotional lack of motivation. It is a physical, like your body just won't let you. It's just, it's like my phone is at 1%, my charger is right behind me. All I need to do is roll over and grab it. But it's just, it feels like walking through like 4 feet of water. You know, when you're in a pool and you're trying to run in the water and there's just this force against you. For me, that's what executive dysfunction has felt like. It's just this immense force that I'm fighting all the time over every little thing. And it makes it really hard to do these things. And with that comes the exhaustion, the hypoactivity, which also makes sense again with the dopamine theory. The hypoactivity could come from the exhaustion of constantly dealing with your ADHD, having to fight against it, having to walk through this 4 feet of water while most other people are just walking around as if they're not in 4 feet of water. We're in the ADHD pool. That could cause the hypoactivity because you're actually literally exhausted. There's also the fact that if you have low dopamine and everything you do, just you don't feel it, you don't feel that reward, you don't feel good. Of course you feel exhausted. It's exhausting to never feel good, to never feel okay, to never feel satisfied, to just, it ends up sometimes feeling like everything is pointless. And this is where the misdiagnosis comes about. Again, I was diagnosed with anxiety and with depression, and I was even diagnosed with all kinds of things that absolutely didn't fit my set of symptoms, but because of the hyper-focusing, for example, sometimes the surges in energy, it was read as manic. Although it was not manic, it was ADHD. It was the manifestation of my hyperactivity. And then there was the hypoactivity, which was read as depressive episodes, but it wasn't. It was hypoactivity from the ADHD, from the low levels of dopamine. So you could see how it's really easy to be misdiagnosed, especially people who are assigned female at birth, because, I mean, it's a long story. It has to do with socialization. It has to do with expectations put on us. It has to do with corrective measures at a young age, stuff like that. A lot of the whole boys will be boys, so sometimes the hyperactivity will be tolerated better in those kids, so they'll carry it on a little later in life. It's a whole thing, but because of that, I feel that there's an underdiagnosis in AFAB individuals. There's definitely an underdiagnosis in adults with ADHD. Some doctors don't even think that adult ADHD is even a thing. I'm looking at you, my past family doctor. But it is. ADHD can carry on into adulthood, and sometimes it's misinterpreted as depression, as anxiety, as laziness, but being lethargic is not the same as being lazy. And trigger warning mental health, trigger warning suicide, just to mentally prepare you for what I'm about to say, but sometimes, at least in my experience, it rendered me suicidal because and big trigger warning here, suicidal thoughts, what I'm about to get to, I want to adequately prepare you for that. There have been a few periods in my life where I've felt like there was no point in living anymore, or that I just actually couldn't live anymore. And it's not to be depressing or self-deprecating. I don't want anyone's pity, nothing like that. It's literally just, I kept being told that I wasn't trying hard enough. My doctor thought that I just needed more motivation, and I tried everything, but it wasn't about that. You can't instill motivation in someone if they don't have the actual, literal, chemical parts necessary to create motivation, to create reward in the brain. You can't instill that in someone. There are things you could do to naturally boost dopamine levels, but there's only so much you could do. If it were that easy, then we would be able to treat people with Parkinson's by increasing their dopamine levels, because Parkinson's is also linked to low dopamine. Like, it's not that simple, and it doesn't always work for everyone. So I ended up feeling like I'm being told that I'm lazy and I'm trying everything, and I don't even have the energy or motivation to keep trying anymore. So what's the point? Like, I'm being treated, I'm doing everything I can. If I'm just lazy, like if this is it, if life is about feeling this way and having to push yourself out of feeling this way every single day, then I don't want it. I can't do it. And that was a scary place to be in, and I 0 out of 10 recommend that. Definitely wasn't a healthy mind space to be in, but this is something that could happen, and this just further feeds into the misdiagnosis of depression, because it's like, oh look, see, now this person has suicidal thoughts, but it's like being told consistently that it's because you're not trying or because you're lazy. It's awful. And most antidepressants deal with serotonin levels, or even occasionally norepinephrine levels, which are also linked to ADHD in their own way. Serotonin wasn't the issue in my brain, and treating me for that was actually just dangerous, because I was not missing serotonin. That was not the issue. I was treated with Wellbutrin, which is active on norepinephrine and dopamine, and that was the only medication that kept me relatively stable but didn't make me better. And when I finally found a doctor who was willing to listen and evaluate me and didn't just take me for my, like, seemingly calm appearance, because they expect someone with ADHD to simultaneously have no manners, this whole thing where it's like, I have ADHD, but I'm also a fully grown adult who's had to adapt to society's expectations of me. I was also socialized female. I've also been corrected from a very young age. So even if I'm inattentive, even if I have no idea what you just said and I'm not listening to you and everything inside of me just wants to speak over you, I will not do it. I will just stay quiet and stay inside my head. So my hyperactivity, my ADHD sometimes is contained inside of me and doesn't physically present itself. But if you're attentive enough, trigger warning, skin picking, you'll notice me fidgeting. You'll notice the actual holes in my skin from picking at my skin for years and years and years. My hyperactivity has manifested itself in subtle ways that don't disturb others, but that deeply disturb myself. So sometimes you're not lucky enough to find a doctor who's willing to look past just what they see on the absolute surface and look just a little further. I mean, the scars from skin picking are literally on the surface, but you know, I guess it takes someone a little more attentive or open-minded, I don't know. So, I don't want to make this video drag on. I just wanted to kind of talk about the different types of ADHD and the dopamine theory and why that has been such a game changer for me in terms of understanding why I feel the way that I do some days. Anyway, that's it. Let me know if you have any questions. I could make dedicated videos about the different types of ADHD in depth if that's something you're interested in. Let me know. Leave a comment. Let me know your thoughts. And that's it. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you have a great day and a great week, and you take care of yourselves. All right, thanks. Bye.